You know, first thing I want you to take notice too, and this is all going to make sense in a little bit. First, where the family is standing in front of the cross.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
You know, the other thing is, you know, reveal yourself and change me deep inside. So they're actually standing at a door, and we're going to get into that. Right? Change, go to the next one. You're the one that formed me deep inside. What did it say? Reveal your power and bring the dead to life. You know, this is a place that we're going to be talking about, right? This is where we come and die so that we can live.
Right?
Right? Watch this. Keep going. You're my redeemer. This is where we're at right now. This is what it's about, the altar and the laver. We're going to talk about it. You're the one who gave your life for mine. Man, we don't just pick this stuff out. Let me just tell you what, real quick, and hold it right there. This is what the message is today I'm going to talk to you about. Lord wanted me to, we're in a series of build it according to the pattern I showed you, the church. And church means ecclesia, those that are called out. Build it according to the pattern. But the Lord wanted me to go back through these pieces with you again. Because it's an important, it's very, very important that you understand what these pieces are. And you're going to see, it's going to be really good. So this is what we're getting into today, all right? Again, we talked about the altar, the laver, and the sacrifice. That's what this is right here. A cross, the family is before the altar, which is the cross, coming to his feet. You're my redeemer. Christ redeemed this. You're the one that gave your life for me. This is where it happened. Go ahead. You're my creator, all right? You're the one who formed me deep inside. All I want is to know you, right? Well, let me tell you something. You don't get to know him out here.
No.
You have to go, you see that door right there they're standing in front of? If you don't know, the cross is a door. Jesus said that he was the door in John 10:9. And every door in the Bible, door in the Hebrew is doleth, which means door. It's the number 4, right? He's the door, standing in front of the temple door in Solomon. No one can get to the Father except through me. The only way you can get to know him is to come into the holy place.
Yeah.
I got a good question for you guys today. The Lord gave me when I was sitting in my office. All I want is to know you. You're the God who loves me. That's the, more than anything, you getting to know one another, that's good, and you can be refreshed by one another. But if you don't get to know him, well then, you know, and there's times of refreshing that the Bible talks about 5 or 6 times in the Bible that will come, right? You can either accept it or reject it. They rejected it, actually, you know, in Isaiah 28, they rejected it. I'm going to read the scripture to you. I was sitting up there and the Lord, you know, always speaks to me through worship. Amazing. Listen to this right here. You want to get to know the Lord. You can't worship him out here. You understand? Worship is done on the inside when he begin to reveal, when he's revealing himself. And if you don't understand, you will shortly. It says in Isaiah 28 verse 9, "Whom shall I teach knowledge? And whom shall I make to understand the message?" Doctrine, the Bible says. "Them that are weaned from milk and have been drawn from the breasts." The Bible says this is the milk of the word. "Repent and be baptized for remission of sins, every one of you, and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." We can go into the presence of God now. So, whom shall I teach knowledge and understanding? Those who have been weaned off of this. This is the essential pieces of the doctrine of faith of believing in Jesus Christ, that he's the Messiah and the Savior. This is what the majority of Christians and everybody who ain't, who's not, even in the world, knows Jesus. Yeah, I know, he's the one that died on the cross, right? Everybody. He split time. No other man in history has split time. He changed the calendar. That's pretty amazing. It's, you know, AD and BC. No one before him or after him. The Bible says, anyone, right, that's come before me And now, I'm going to say, even after me is a robber and a thief. Christ is the only one. If you, you know, the world has lined up according to his death, burial, and resurrection.
Amen.
The calendars, bam! When he died, something happened.
Yeah.
There was a separation between something old, A.D., B.C., before Christ, and A.D., after his death. That even our very calendars and the whole world goes by his death. If you don't believe me, go to NASA.gov. They'll tell you and show you when he died. Most important in anything, right? Nobody else in the world has ever split time. Nobody. I don't care who your God is. Jesus is the only one, right? So, watch this right here. Whom shall I teach knowledge, and whom shall I make to understand the doctrine, the message? Them that are weaned from the milk and drawn from the breasts. For precept must be upon precept, and line upon line, and here a little and there a little. And he says, for with stammering lips and another tongue shall I speak unto my people, to whom he said, this is the rest. Now watch. He's talking about Christ right here. They're looking for rest. It's actually refreshing. You're going to see it. To whom he said, this is the rest wherewith you may cause the weary to rest. And this is the refreshing. Yet they would not hear it. They wouldn't hear it. The gospel being preached to them, Jesus is the Messiah, he's the Savior of the world, you know, but they don't want to be refreshed. They don't want to hear it, right? Got a question for you. It's a good one. It's going to be good today. Let's pray. Father, we come to you in Jesus' name, Lord, just like your word says. There's only one way to the Father. There's only one way to get to you, Lord, and that's through your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, cleanse us, Father, today. Cleanse me, Father, of my sins, Lord, by the blood of your Son, Lord. Lord, we invite your Spirit and your presence, Lord. I just ask, Father, today, Lord, that you would open up the hearts. Father, that you would open the ears. Father, I give them eyes to see, ears to hear, and a heart to understand today. Father, I bind the enemy in Jesus' name from off your word. Yeah. Lord, your word says that it'll accomplish everything it's been set forth to do. So, Father, I pray in Jesus' name that it pierces the hearts of the people that are here today and, Lord, those who see it on YouTube and wherever it might go. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, and amen. Got a question for you guys. I was going to call you up individually and pick you out and tell you to come up here and explain this to me. Like Pete, he was the first one I thought about.
Oh God.
I was like, gonna say, hey Pete, come up here and tell me what you know about this altar and this labor. Tell me what it is, the understanding that you got. Think about that, me calling you up right now, if I said that to you. Pete, come up here and tell me what this altar and this labor means.
Really calling me?
Yeah, I'm calling you up here, Pete. Calling up here.
And look, y'all forgive me. I'm distracted. That Michi were dealing with that tornado, and they just called me right before I got up to play. Get 5 people out here right now. You know, they told me no overtime this weekend, so just bear with me. So about the altar and the labor.
Now watch this. I want to know, Pete, about the altar and the labor. You tell me what these pieces represent.
First thing.
Stop. Now you can go sit down. Now what if you was put on a spot like that? I wasn't going to let him say anything. But you need to understand what this altar and this labor is. And what it represents. And I know instantly, everybody was like, uh-oh. Is he going to call me? Is he calling me up there?
No, I was thinking, you better not call me.
So Mama's thinking. Now, Mama saved, been in church. I'm 47 years old. She got saved. She accepted Jesus 47 years ago. And she's saying, you better not call me. It ain't about me calling you. It's about when God calls you. You've been called to this every day. Everybody, this is, and listen, it's not about preaching to you, it's about teaching you.
Right.
So that you'll have an understanding. I don't want to put you on a spot, but I want you guys, instead of getting up here and preaching to you and waiting at 12 o'clock and everybody running out to beat the next person at the buffet over there, because that's what happens.
Yeah.
Right? And if you ask them when they get to the buffet, what was the service about? It was good. What was it? Tell me.
I know.
It's, you know. So what did they get? They got a buffet at the Chinese restaurant. That was good. Boy, and watch this. What did you eat? Man, I ate chicken. Man, I ate dirty rice. Man, I ate all. Hey, why can you rehearse what you ate there and not rehearse what you ate here?
Come on.
Something's wrong.
Yeah.
Yeah. Amen.
Yeah.
Right?
Right. Amen.
This is soul food right here. I like that.
Indeed.
This is soul, real soul food. I mean, we can throw a balling pot on top of this altar. Oh, and ball of crabs. Uh-oh, Lord. Nothing unclean can go on this altar. We can't ball crabs on this altar. We can do it outside in the tent, right?
Yeah.
Anyway. So, I got a question for you. How many of you guys want to go to heaven? How many of you guys want to be with the Lord?
Absolutely. Yes.
Man, we all, I mean, who? I mean, there's only, there's either heaven or there's hell.
You're not selling tickets, are you?
Selling tickets? No, I'm not. Selling tickets where? Oh, no, I'm not selling tickets. It's all good. Everybody wants to be in the presence of the Lord,
absolutely,
the Savior. I mean, we're His children, right? I got a question for you. Here's the question. How many of you guys know John, the beloved, who wrote the book of Revelation? Has everybody heard?
Yeah.
Everybody's heard him?
Yeah.
Revelation, it's not Revelations. It's the book of Revelations. It means apocalypto, which means the unveiling or the revealing of Jesus. That's what the book of Revelation is about. Where did John meet Jesus at? Where at? Where was he at when he met Jesus? Tell me.
Met him way before that.
Okay. All right, wait. When Jesus spoke to John, where was he at?
Fishing. In Galilee.
I'm in the book of Revelations.
Oh.
Where was John?
He was in prayer.
Listen. Where was John when Jesus began to speak to him about his churches? Where was he?
In prayer.
What? Nobody.
Caught up in the spirit.
Where was he at? Physically, where was he at?
The Isle of Patmos.
No, he was not. Tell me, where? He was caught up in the first heaven. Where was he at now? Where was... Where was John when Jesus began to speak to him?
In the holy place.
Thank you.
Okay.
How much more play you get at men? Golly, when Jesus spoke to John, where was he at? I took you to the book of Revelation. Ask the question. John was caught up where? When Jesus began to speak to him? In the holy place. Right? Here's the question. Why was John allowed in the holy place? Why was he allowed in the holy place?
Because he was caught up in the spirit.
He'd already died to the flesh and been baptized.
Thank you, sir. There it is, right there. Say it again, Walt.
You'd already died to the flesh and been baptized.
That's the only way. That's the only reason he was let in. John was in the Spirit on the Lord's Day. He was in prison for the testimony of Jesus Christ. What was the testimony of Jesus Christ? That he had died and rose again. He was bearing witness. He himself had died to self, been born again, resurrected. He's in prison for that, bearing these two as a witness in his life. That's the only way he was allowed to come into heaven, into the holy place. Right, watch. If the priest makes the sacrifice and he doesn't wash in the laver, what happens if he went in?
He died.
So John had a witness in his life that he had died and rose again, spiritually speaking. That's the only way that he was let into the holy place in heaven. It's pretty amazing, right? Good stuff. Watch this. The question was, why was John? So the Lord asked me when I was in my writing my lesson down, and I wrote this right here. And this is when the Lord asked me. I wrote, I was talking about the altar and the laver together, and we'd get into it. I wrote here, number 9, the only way into the kingdom of God, this is the only way that we can get into the kingdom of God, right?
Right.
And the Lord, right there, spoke to me, and he said, why was John allowed into heaven? I'm like, what? Right? The Spirit just spoke to me right there. Why was John allowed into heaven? And I'm like, wow. Because he had the testimony of Jesus Christ. I'm going to read it to you. Watch this. This is the only way he was allowed in. And what I'm doing is showing you the only way into heaven is through Christ. Watch this. He says, I, John, Revelations 1:9, am also your brother and companion in tribulation. So coming to Jesus Christ doesn't mean everything's easy, right?
Right. Mm-hmm.
He says, and I was in the kingdom of patience. Let me start over. I, John, who also am your brother and companion in tribulation and in the kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, because we're waiting on his return, I was in the isle that's called Patmos. He was in prison physically. For the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. And I was in the Spirit on a Lord's day, and I heard a voice as one that spoke with me as a trumpet that called him up. Where did he call him up? From the Isle of Patmos, in the Spirit, he said. His physical body was still in prison. Right. He left, went into heaven, and he was granted to come in here. Why? Because he had the testimony of Jesus Christ. The Word, that's what he was professing. The only way you can get in is through the testimony of Jesus Christ. There's no other way.
Right.
So, if I put you on a spot, you ought to be able to tell me what this altar represents. Remember, I showed you guys, I told you about the altar, what it meant. I told you about the laver, what it meant. I told you about the altar and a laver together, how they're one piece.
Yeah.
And what it represented. And that's the only way that you can actually come in. You see, watch this. You see this family standing here? That is called the door into, you see the light behind it? That would be where the presence of God is. I know it's a sun right there, but that's not what I'm talking about. The only way you could come into the presence of God is through the cross. The cross represents the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And I'm going to show you that. That's what it represents. That's milk. You should be able to tell me, looking at this altar, how long you been serving the Lord now? Been serving the Lord a long time? So you should be able to say, hey, I know what this altar represents. Watch this. And you don't have to tell me. I'm going to tell you. I don't need the book, but I'm going to read it to you so I don't miss anything. Okay? Watch this. The series that we're doing right now is called Build It According to the Pattern That I've Showed You. God is building His church, right? He built His church on the rock, the stone, the chief cornerstone, which is Jesus Christ, right? The altar and its utensils. That means this laver was part of this. It's the altar and its utensils. It's not a separate piece. You have to experience both of these pieces and all the utensils that went with it. The forks, the meat hooks, the brazen cups, everything was made of brass, right? The color bronze represents judgment or suffering. That's what it represents, bronze. Remember, it represents, remember, the heaven shall become like brass unto you. That's not good.
No.
Right? So, brass, biblically, when you see it over and over in the Bible, it represents suffering or judgment. So when God told Moshe, to build an altar, He said, build an altar and its utensils, and He said, the laver, He said, make it of brass, because this is a picture where Christ would die. It was 7.5 foot by 7.5 foot. It was 5 foot off the ground. It was an elevated structure. This is where you would bring your sacrifice, wrap the rope around the horns. They would have it around its neck or its horns. And this is where the sacrifice would die. They would catch the blood in the cup. They would pour it on the horns of the altar and bring it into the holy place. Okay? Horns represent power and authority. That's what horns represent. Why? Power and authority. Because if you get two deer together, they fight, it's by their horns. The bigger horns wins. Rams, bam, power and authority. Horns represent sin in the Bible. Remember, it's the horns, the power and authority of sin that has control of our life, holds us bounded to sin by the horns. How do we know that? In the Bible, with Abraham, when Abraham was going to sacrifice Isaac on the altar, he was obedient. He was about to sacrifice his son. Remember, Isaac is a picture of Christ, carried the wood on his back. Watch this. Isaac is a picture of the altar and the laver, the death, burial, and resurrection. Isaac was a picture of Christ to come. Isaac's carrying the wood on his shoulders, goes on a 3-day journey, leaves his mom. Abraham brings the sacrifice, right? Actually went on, it was a day, but it was 3 days he was gone. Puts the wood on his back. It's a picture of Christ carrying the cross. Goes on Mount Moriah, right where Christ is crucified. He's going to sacrifice him. God stops him because he believed God. Why was that a picture of the altar and a laver? We have an altar. He's going to sacrifice him. The angel stops him. It's a picture of Christ, right? Where's the laver there? Wow.
Because of Abraham's faith.
Because of Abraham's faith. That's right.
In Abraham's mind, Isaac was already dead. God raised him back up.
Bam, son! Walt, you hit it again!
What do you say?
Walt said, because Abraham already considered him dead, that God was able to resurrect him again. Altar, laver. Brought him back 3 days later. He was alive. A picture of Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. That's some understanding. That's what I'm talking about. Watch this. When God called him the minister, why? Because he knows. He has an understanding. Watch this. Remember, the horns, remember, when Abraham, he didn't sacrifice his son. What was caught in a thorn bush? A ram. By what? Its horns. It was caught in what? A thorn bush. Why thorns? Thorns represent the curse. It represents the curse that Christ would bear. That's why he wore the crown. He would take the curse. So, the place of the altar is outside the gates. That's why Jesus died outside the gates of the city. That's where this was stationed, right outside the tabernacle, right outside the temple. The priestly duties were, right here, was to help those that was offering a sacrifice. The Bible says that we are priests in God's house. When somebody is, you know, when you begin to tell them, when they want to make an offering, what is that? Lay down your life, a living sacrifice. We're supposed to be assisting people and leading them to the Father. Well, what do I have to do? Well, you have to die to self and you have to be baptized. Well, how do you know that? Well, can you tell them about an altar in the Bible and a laver in the Bible? Can you go to a spot in the Bible and say, hey, look, Abraham with his son, that was an altar and a laver. Joshua and the 12 stones, that was an altar and a laver in Joshua where Jesus was baptized. Noah and the ark. Egypt was an altar. All the firstborn died. They went straight to the Red Sea. That's an altar and a laver. Every place in the Bible, it's about an altar and a laver. You see this picture, my friend, over and over and over again. It's through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ that's the only way we get to enter in. Because the other thing is to try to come into the door. Right? It ain't St. Peter at the door, I'm sorry. Every place in the Bible is Jesus. And that's just making fun. Because a lot of people tell jokes, when I get up to heaven, St. Peter going to be at the gate. I'm going to say, hey, what's going on? And he's going to say, hey, I'm not Peter. I'm Jesus. And who are you? Uh-oh. And who are you?
I don't want to hear that.
In the Bible, remember 10 virgins, 5 were foolish, 5 were wise. 5 came at the door, it was late. Open up to us. God, who are you? Be gone from me, where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. But look, I'm just trying to get you through the milk.
Yeah.
To bring you in here.
Yeah.
You got to get this first. And I know you've experienced because you've accepted Jesus as your personal Savior and you've been baptized, right?
Yeah.
And you believe that Jesus is the Messiah.
Absolutely.
Can you tell people about that?
Yeah.
What if somebody's like, well, how do you know that? Man, let me tell you, let me show you. Because I'll show you 10 places in the Bible where it shows an altar and a laver, and a guy's name that just so happens to get on top of the altar is named Joshua, whose name means Jesus. What is that, a coincidence or something? And you start going, Noah's name means rest, and the Bible says that we're to strive to enter into that rest, and that rest is Jesus Christ. And they just said just now that we just read in Isaiah 28, the true rest is to get off of the milk.
Yeah.
And move on to the doctrine and the understanding and the wisdom. And wait, hold on a second. So that you can know Him.
Right.
So that you can know Him. Because you don't get to know Him out here.
Yeah.
All you know is about Him out here.
Yeah.
And you know what's amazing? That when John went in, what did Jesus want to talk to John about? His church.
Yeah.
The condition of his church.
Wow, yeah.
Amen. Yeah.
He wanted to talk to him about the condition of the called out ones, not a building.
Right.
The ecclesia, those that have been called out. John, I want you to write a letter to the 7 churches that are in Asia Minor. I want you to write to Smyrna. I want you to tell them this. That if they don't straighten up, I'm going to come and remove that candlestick.
Wow.
What? That's pretty serious stuff. He called the churches candlesticks. And if they don't straighten up, he's going to take the light from them.
Yeah.
Christ is the light of the world. He's going to remove his light from that church? What does that mean? That ain't good. The absence of light, and if you're in darkness, you're in trouble. So, what I'm trying to show you, and I want you to get, understand that these two pieces that are outside, there was a door here in the tabernacle. This is outside, an altar and a laver. That's why Jesus was taken outside the city gates, the house of God, the temple. He was taken outside the city gates to fulfill a prophecy that he would be raised up. Remember, it's an altar an elevated place. I told you in Revelations where it says his feet was as burned as brass in a furnace. Right? Watch this. Good stuff. The priestly duties was helping those who was making a sacrifice. Their service was to, just as they had a service in the tabernacle and temple, you and I have a priestly duty. Wherever you go, you're a living tabernacle. And your feet are supposed to be carrying the gospel. Yeah. That's what this is. The feet. We come to the foot of the cross. His feet were burned as brass. You can either let people in, or you're an open door or a closed door. You're some kind of door. You can either be a good door or a bad door. Where are you leading people? Because you are a door. The Bible says that. The Bible says, open up, O ye gates, ye doors. You are a door, a conduit in which God, through the Holy Spirit, is trying to get through you to get to others to do what? To lead them back to Him.
Amen.
Flesh was prohibited on this. Lay down your life a living sacrifice, Romans 12. Die to self every day, Paul said. This is your reasonable service. Why? Because every morning you get up, your flesh is renewed. Every day, die. So that you can do what? Just as Christ came to do the will of the Father, so now we're doing the will of the Father by following what Christ done. Laying down your life. That's why we're called Christians. We become like Christ to do what it is that He's called us to do. That's why a son in a family does his father's will. You're training up your child in the way he should go. Right? And if he's not doing, if the son is not doing what the parents has called him to do, he's disobedient. You're training him right now. Why? So that when they get older, train up a child in the way they should go. When they are old, they won't depart from it. So that when we get at full age, we will do the will of God.
Yes.
Because it's not about your will being done. It's not about what you want to do. It's about what God has called you and me to do every day. When people encounter you, they should encounter a tabernacle of the Most Holy God.
Amen.
And if they don't see that in you, something's wrong. You need to get back on the altar and die to self.
Right.
What's coming out of you? F-bombs? Yeah. Cursing? Dirty language? Dirty jokes? What do you talk about the most? What is your passion? In fact, that church, I think it's Smyrna, this is what God said to him. I know you do this and you do that, and those are, they are good things. But I have this against you. You lost your first love. And get it back, or I'm going to remove your candlestick.
Right.
What is your passion in life? Is it Jesus? I just need to be around you a little bit. That's it. Don't take long. Because what's ever in you is going to come out of you. I'm going to find out real soon, real quick, what you live for. My son, he's 16. He talks about cars. I'm training him. I'm still kicking him and training him and telling him about Jesus. I know Mama did me the same thing. There came a time in my life, you know what, Mama? All I want to do is talk about Jesus. When you meet him, man, he's a life changer. The altar. Why is it brass, church?
Suffering and judgment.
Right. What does it represent? What does the altar and the laver represent?
Death, resurrection, washing.
So when you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, everything's going to be easy.
No.
Well, just come on up here and accept Jesus right now. Look, you're going to have a good life, and He's going to bless you. He's going to give you everything you want. You ain't got to worry about nothing.
No.
Is that what it represents? Because I don't see that here.
No.
And I don't see it nowhere else in the Bible. In fact, when the children of Israel were taken out of Egypt, They experienced an altar. They put the blood on the door, which is Christ, a picture of Christ. I am the door. No one can get to the Father except through me. The firstborn in Egypt died. Jesus being the firstborn of the begotten, the Lamb of God, he would have to die. Then he takes them straight from an altar, Egypt, straight to a laver. Yeah. The Red Sea. Altar, laver. Before he can bring them to the mountain of God, Mount Sinai, where God gave them the law.
Right.
The process in which God had laid out, altar, laver, death, burial, and resurrection. You can't bypass it. You can't go around it. Can't go over it. Can't go under it. You got to go through it.
Right. Amen.
Right?
Right.
It's the only way. What's my notebook? It says, this is your first peace and your encounter with God.
Right.
Your first peace. Because in the tabernacle, there was a 7 foot high white tent, or actually a wall, white wall that went all the way around. It was closed in all the way except the front, right here. They had what they called the gate. Now this was only made of linen, and it hung on 5 poles in the front. And it was made of blue, purple, and scarlet, and fine twine linen. And when you came, you couldn't just walk right through the middle of it. The way it was set up, the tent made a big rectangle, and the sides came in like this, and the sides came in like this, and then this linen gate that was in the front went right past it on this side. So actually, when you come in, you'd have to come in like this, and then the linen thing, meaning that if you was out here looking at it, you would see this linen veil that was in the front. You with me?
Yeah.
Then you would come and you'd walk around it and you'd walk in. This would be the first thing you saw.
Yeah.
This altar, this laver, then another veil, which is a door.
Right.
This veil out here was called the way. This is the way. Isn't it something? It's called the way. The way what? The way in. There ain't no other gate, north, south, east, or west. I mean, actually, only coming in from the east headed west was the gate. There's nothing on the north, the south, and the west. This is the only way. You got to come through this gate. This gate right here, this veil, it had cherubim on it. Made of blue, purple, and scarlet, and fine twine linen. When you came in, this is the first thing you would see when you come into the tabernacle. This is the way. The door is the truth. That's life. The only way to the Father is through Him. He is the gate.
Right.
He is the way. That's what He said. That's why they wanted to kill Him over and over. That's why I told you in the beginning, He split time. Tell me someone else who has done this. Why has time revolved around Him if He's not the one? Tell me that. It ain't Buddha, it ain't Muhammad, it ain't none other ones, because he says anyone that's come before or after me is a liar and a thief.
Right.
He's the way. He's the one that died. He's the one that rose again. Buddha, go to his grave site, he's still there. Muhammad, go to his grave site, he's still there. And every other one before him or after him is still in the grave.
Right.
He's the only one that got up.
That's it.
Ah!
Amen.
Know it. It's not an easy walk. You won't be liked. You won't be favored. You will be talked about. You will be set apart. You will be rejected. Because that's what he said.
Right.
Expect tribulation. He said, this is our first peace in our encounter. This is a picture of the cross, the altar, and the laver. That's why Jesus bled. They pierced his side. Blood and water flowed from his side. Why? That's new birth. That's why it says, unless your man is born again, he's died to his old man, resurrected a new man, he cannot enter into the kingdom of heaven. John 3:16, most read, most misunderstood. Probably, I guarantee it. Because if they truly knew what it was to die, we would really be seeing a whole lot more of Christ.
Yeah.
The Bible says that we're called to carry our cross. What cross are you carrying? It ain't yours. What you have been called to carry is the cross of Jesus Christ.
Right.
You understand that? That altar and that laver that they put on his shoulders. Priests bore things on their shoulders. They carried it.
Right.
That's what you and I are. What are you carrying? Your altar? Your Taj Mahal? What are you building? Your kingdom or his? What are you carrying? By carrying the cross, you become a door to the Father. Though I speak to you as man, serious stuff. The altar, place of death. The laver. It's bronze. It's a place of washing. The priest had to wash. Represents the word of God. When I went to Israel in 2006, when the Lord had showed me that Jerusalem was literally and physically the modern day Garden of Eden, I could prove it to you beyond a shadow of a doubt from the Bible that Jerusalem was literally and physically the Garden of Eden. The Lord revealed that to me. I went to Israel 2006. I get over there, we get to this little shop, and was eating falafels. I said, "You want a falafel?" I said, "I don't even know what it is." "Oh, you American people, you know nothing. Eat a falafel. Hey, what do you want to drink? Want a $5 Coke?" "No, how about a $4 water?" They brought the water out to me, and they set the water down on a table in 2006. You know what the water on the bottle says? Eden. It says Eden. I put orange tape around it. Yep. Confirmation. This is how the Lord speaks. Why do you think the water run out of the temple? Where did the water come up? Out of the temple, underneath the door, through the gate? Right? Where's the temple? Where did the river flow out of? Eden. Right? And made a head and went four ways? Go to Ezekiel 47. And there was a river that come out of the temple, right? Under the door, a river of life, flowed out of the door to the gate. Ezekiel walks north, goes around because he couldn't go out the eastern gate, right? It was blocked for the Messiah to come through. Walked around it. He seen the river, got in it. It was water to his ankles, right?
Right.
Water to his ankles. Then he went a little deeper. Water to his knees. Yeah. Then he went a little deeper. Water to his waist. Then he says there was waters to swim in.
Yeah.
And I'm swimming all around. And when I got to the shore, he was in a garden.
Yeah.
I do that by Pete because he loves it. That was. He says he swam to the shore. There was trees all around. 6,000 feet from the eastern gate of Jerusalem is exactly what he went. 1,500 feet, 1,500 feet, 1,500 feet, 1,500 feet. You're standing in the Garden of Gethsemane. Ooh, what did you say? That's right, you heard me. The garden that was eastward in Eden is modern day. The Garden of Gethsemane. Why did Jesus go there often? How did Judas know where he went? He was the last Adam always going to the garden. First Adam was in the garden. Does God plant his garden 700 miles away in Iraq? Where is God's house? Where is the new holy city, Jerusalem, going to come down? Modern day Jerusalem. Where did God tell Abraham he was going to take his people to a land that flowed with milk and honey? Where did God take Abraham? From eastward Babylon, Ur the Chaldeans, to northward Hebron, to Jerusalem. Where did God lead the children of Israel? He's going to lead them to a land that flows with milk and honey. Where did he lead them? Ah. Wow. Why? Because God said, "I've placed my shin there." You know what a shin is? His sign. He stamped it with his name. Where did Jesus come to? Iraq? No. came to Jerusalem. Where God walked with man in the beginning, he walks with him in the end. Wow. Plain as day. Right in their face. But because we've been taught by the History Channel, the garden that was eastward in Eden is over by the Tigris and Euphrates, where the Tigris and the Euphrates run right now, after the flood, after the flood of Noah's day. Oh, the Garden of Eden is somewhere over there. Wrong again, Tonto. I found the Tree of Life in Jerusalem. Was Jesus in Iraq? The Bible says he is the Tree of Life. He is the olive branch that returned to the very spot that he created Adam. The same place he's going to return to, the laver. Bronze, suffering. It's a place of washing. The priest didn't wash. They tried to go in. They died.
Right.
What does that say to you and me? Lay down your life, a living sacrifice every day. This is your reasonable service. That means the dirt that you go out in the world with every single day, physically, you get dirty, you take a bath. Spiritually, when you're in the world, you need to wash in the Word. Why? Because that dirt will rub off on you, and when you get around people, they'll see it.
Come on.
See it.
Yeah.
I see it. I see it, and I'm not pointing at any individual. People will see it all over you.
Yeah.
The Bible says the righteous purifieth themselves. Judge yourselves, Paul said, to see if you're in the faith or not.
Yeah.
What faith? The faith of the death, burial, and resurrection that you're carrying your cross. His cross every single day. And I don't mean the one around your neck. Because that don't mean nothing.
Right.
Nothing. It only means that you'll have to stand before that one. Right there. And I hope you're ready. I hope your shoes are bronze. I remember when the Lord said, pull your pants legs up, take off your shoes and socks, and spray paint your feet bronze. I had to send my brother, go run to Home Depot real quick, get me some bronze spray paint, come back. Man, the altar and the laver. Watch this. I pulled my pants legs up there, and people freaked out at resurrection. Remember? They were like, is his feet bronze? Yeah, how you like that? They didn't know what I was doing. I started taking my shoes and socks off. They was like, oh my God, he gonna lose it. He's losing it. No, I just want to show you my bronze feet.
I didn't know it.
Right? Brass, bronze. Wow, that's right. Doc, hey, my feet are bronze. What do you suppose that is? Get you some, man, I keep sticking them in a fire every day. Well, that might be why you're having problems. Right? It's considered part of the altar. They're one.
Right.
My brother did it the best the other day. You see, a lot of people says, oh, I repented, but I ain't been baptized. I don't need to be baptized. Well, yeah, go ahead and face the Lord. That's fine, because he said in the old covenant, if the priest rejected this, they would die when they came in the presence of the Lord. So look, if you want to stand before the Lord with one foot, with one bronze foot, because you ain't stuck the other one in, you're in trouble.
Yeah.
Ah! Son! If you ain't stuck the foot in, if you only got one bronze foot, well, I died to self, but you know what? I ain't getting baptized. Well, you only got one bronze shoe on, son. You a one-legged idiot. You're a one-legged idiot. Because every place in the Bible, Noah's Ark, how did God cleanse the earth?
Water.
Noah, by faith moved, built an ark, which represents Christ, pitched it, atoned, kafarded it, it means atonement, went in through one door. There was not another door on the ark. Death and water baptizes the earth. Jesus himself was baptized. Did you hear me? Jesus himself, who had no sin, got in the water and was baptized while he was standing on an altar of 12 stones. An altar and a laver. The altars that were made were not crafted by human hand, God said, because if a man does it, he would defile it. It was made of stone in the beginning. 12 stones. Get on it. Oh, Moses built an altar at the foot of Sinai and the rock of Horeb split. Altar, laver. Joshua, 12 stones under the water. Altar, the Jordan, the laver. Solomon's temple, the brazen sea, 12 bulls underneath it. Altar, laver. Ah! Don't tell me. I know the way. I know the way. There's only one way. And you have to die to yourself. Pick up. We say carry your cross, pick up your cross. Well, let me tell you something. The only cross that I'm carrying is my Savior's. He died on it. For me, that is your reasonable service. I'll read to you, blow you away, Romans 12, because the message of the word and how it's being ministered is coming through a tabernacle temple presentation. What do you think it means in Ephesians 5 when it says washing and the regeneration of the word? Wives, love your husbands. Husband, love your wives. As Christ loved the church. As Christ loved the church and gave himself for it, Ephesians 5, and washed it by the washing of the regeneration of the word. That's an altar and a laver. Come and get you some of that. This is good stuff. Crazy. I'm crazy for Jesus. Amen. You need to know so you can tell people. You don't have to know it all. But if somebody says, hey man, why? If you can just show them one other altar and laver. Man, and I know there's more. My pastor, he's crazy. Go on YouTube. He'll, man. We wear rain jackets there. Because he'll spit all over you, son. And it's not holy either. It stinks. Wow. Amazing. Watch this. It was going to be a short service today. The Lord said, eh. Is it a long one again? Let me tell you something. If it's too long, there's a door. I tell everybody in this place, if you think I preach too long, find another church. Because let me tell you something, I ain't getting off the altar. And when the Lord says stop, I'll stop.
Right. That's it.
You can sit down at a buffet.
Well, come on now.
How long can we sit at a buffet?
Come on.
How, wait, say it, how long?
Hours.
Hours.
Especially if you go with big fish.
Yes. Oh, big fish, you can forget about it. Big fish are going to stay there. Hey, check this out. Repentance and baptism. So important was this piece that if the priest could not enter the holy place, if they did, they would die. It's a picture of baptism and our necessity of washing in the word. Washing in the word. If you want to find out, look, inside this laver right here, inside this laver, I want everybody to see it. I just went through the Bible, and inside this laver, I went and picked out 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 places in the Bible, and I glued the pages in the inside where it talks about you need to be baptized. Old covenant!
Yeah.
and maybe two pages in the New Testament, the New Covenant. This is how you wash in the regeneration of the Word. It was made of the looking glasses of women. Why? Bronze looking glasses from women. So you could see yourself in the reflection of the Word so you can get the dirt off.
You ever go
someplace and you're sitting there with somebody and they got something on their face? Or maybe hanging out their nose. Oh man, that ain't good. But you're like sitting there looking at it. Everybody could see it, but nobody want to tell them anything. Right. They got some of you, hey, got the big old booger right there. Take it off.
Aww.
Right. I could say that.
No.
Yes, I can. Absolutely. Mama said I can't say booger.
Not like that.
Let me tell you something. We ain't even going to, look, it's all good. If you ain't free, well, he need to be set free.
Yeah.
You need to know how to say it.
Okay. Oh, you need to know how to say how you got something on your face. Okay. Listen. Listen to what I'm telling you. Because you know what? Let me tell you something. What's going to happen is a person who sees it, they'll never forget it. That crazy preacher said, you need to wash in the Word. He described it like, you know, something out of somebody hanging in somebody's nose.
They'll remember it.
That's exactly right. They will remember it. I remember when Pastor Allen was teaching, he took a turkey or something it was, and he was teaching on you got to be absolutely dead on the altar. And he had a dead chicken, its head was, he took it, went and bought it at Winn-Dixie, took that chicken. Now this is like 20 years ago, and slung that chicken. He said, now look, boom, that thing hit, big piece of meat hit the ground. This is what they sacrifice, stuff like that thing is dead. You see, that's how you're supposed to be. And guess what? I ain't never forgot it. I remember when Pastor Allen's daddy did a presentation about being a light. And how he did it, by visual. He set up, you got a bathroom light, asked one of the guys to put an extension cord on it, and he had four light bulbs on it. One was a 40 watt, one was a 60 watt, one was a 75 watt, one was a 100 watt. I'll never forget it. He said, let me tell you something. You can either be a 40 watt, and he turned it on. You could be a 60 watt, a 75 watt, or a 100 watt for Jesus. What watt do you want to burn for him?
Yeah.
I watched that resurrection life. I watched them beat cars up with malls.
What? Come on.
Bashing a TV?
I watched them take a TV and smash it with a mall on the altar. Things that you put between you and Christ. Getting me off track. Watch this.
Field drain on the other side.
Remember he preached about the grass and drain them?
Yeah, he preached about the grass. People think the grass is greener on the other side, but when you get over there, you find it's crabgrass. This place, a picture of where the church is to wash itself on a daily basis, staying in connection. Whether it's you in the Word, whether you're in your car listening to praise and worship music, whether you're putting a CD on, you should have that Word. You should be talking about that Word every day. I told you it was made from the looking glasses of women. Let's see. The Word shows us our true reflection. And it's there so to purify ourselves. The righteous purify themselves. Altars and lavers in the Bible, I told you. Adam and Eve had an altar. Noah, altar and laver. Moses, Mount Sinai, altar and laver. Egypt, Red Sea, altar and laver. Joshua and a Jordan, altar and a laver. Tabernacle of Moses, altar and a laver. Solomon's temple, altar and a laver. That's why Peter, when he preached the gospel and it was pricked in their hearts that Jesus died and rose again, they said, men and brethren, what must we do to be saved? Peter stood up and said on that day, check this out. How would you think about this? Peter stood up that day, the day that Joel prophesied that the outpouring of the Holy Spirit was coming. Boy, I bet you Joel would have been on fire to be there and see it happen, son.
Yeah.
Ooh, how about you prophesy something and then, you know, a couple of hundred years later, wouldn't you like to be there to see it come to pass?
Yeah.
Times of refreshing, man. Watch this. The altar and the laver together, what does it represent? Altar and laver together. It represents the death burial in Jesus Christ. It represents your death burial to yourself to follow Jesus Christ. It represents repent and be baptized, Peter said. Repent and be baptized. Oh, I got to go back to where I was at. Peter said when they were pricked in their heart by the gospel that Jesus died on a cross for them, they were pricked and they said, men and brethren, what must we do to be saved? Because you're all sinners going to hell unless you accept Jesus.
Right.
He's not sending you there. He just provided a way out for you.
Right. Yeah.
You realize that? God don't send people nowhere.
Amen.
The life raft has been sent. You can accept it or reject it. Repentance and baptism. Romans chapter 12 said, this is your reasonable service, to lay down your life, a living sacrifice, holy and accepted. Unless a man is born again, the Bible says, you cannot see the kingdom of heaven. I showed you that. That's why John was allowed in. If you don't have the witness of the testimony of Jesus Christ in your life, you're in trouble. You will not be allowed in. You will not be allowed in with one shoe. Because two has to be a witness. Because the Bible says two is a witness.
Right.
Let everything be established by two or three. It represents the gospel that Jesus died and rose again. It represents being born again. How is a baby born? Through blood and water. Blood and water. It's a new birth. You can't get around it. You can't have a baby just blood. Nor does a baby come out just water. It's blood and water and a new birth. And then what happens? Watch. The Bible says repent and be baptized for remission of sins and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Wow. A baby is born through blood and water. And it receives the breath of life. Ah!
Mama, go tell.
How you doing, Ellie? Hold on. Uh-oh. You made a door. Look at that, huh? Wow, let's see. Yes, I am the gate. Wow. Yes, I am the gate. Those who come in through me will be saved. They will come and go freely and will find good pastures. John 10:9. Pretty amazing. You got it, girl. You found the door.
Amen.
He says, Romans 10, chapter 15, it says that this altar and this laver represent the feet of the gospel. Romans 10, 15. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 1, verse 15, and I, John, was caught up in the Lord on the Spirit's day because I had the Spirit, because I bore the witness and the testimony of Jesus Christ. And when he got up there, you can read it in verse 115, chapter 1, verse 15, he said, and when I looked at him, his feet was as burned as brass. And next, very next thing out of his mouth, and his voice was the sound of many waters. I think the Bible says the water is the Word.
Yes.
I think Jesus is the Word made flesh.
Yes.
That was an altar, brazen feet. And his voice as waters. Well, that's an altar and a laver too.
Yeah.
Man, you need to get you some of that.
Amen.
Because you know what happens right after that? Huh, Joe? You'll receive the gift of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
To empower you to preach the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The gospel. It represents your path and my path of suffering. They kill Christians all the time.
Yeah.
They kill all kind of people all the time. But there's coming a day, just like Peter was, and all the disciples all died martyrdom. All of them. John, who survived being thrown in boiling oil.
Yeah.
God said, he was one of the sons of Zebedee, which means the sons of thunder. James and John, whose mother came there and said, hey, grant my sons to sit at the right and the left. He says, you don't know what you ask. Are they able to partake in the cup? What cup? The cup of suffering And they said, "We are." Death. And he said, "You will." Yes. When John got out of prison, somebody killed him. Why? Because he had the testimony of Jesus Christ. And at that time, around 95 AD, when he wrote Revelation, between 90 and 95, they were killing him, son. They couldn't wait. Oh, John's free. He's dead. Right, yes. 300 years the church lived underground, buried. Kind of sound familiar? Christ buried for 3 days and rose again. Around 330, when Constantine said everything's good, 330, they all come up out of the ground. What? That's a resurrection! Wait, Tony, you just gave me another death, burial, and resurrection! The church died, was buried in the catacombs of Rome, rose again around 330. Ah! Man, is that awesome or what? I'm almost done. The only way into the kingdom of God is through the altar and the laver. These two become one. The only way for you to receive the Holy Spirit and the power to preach the gospel to overcome the devil is by repent and be baptized and receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, son. Just like a baby. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15, I give you the natural things of this world so you'll understand the things of the Spirit. The marriage, the children, the church. The only way to receive the Holy Spirit, this is the only way to receive the Spirit, the power to preach the gospel, overcome the wiles of the devil, Holy Ghost power. The Bible says that times of refreshing are coming, right? Refresh means to renew or to restore, and I ain't going to read it. But you can be refreshed in your spirit, 1 Corinthians 16, verse 18. You can be refreshed in your heart, Philippians, verse 7 and 20. You could be, refreshing is often needed, 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 16. It's mutual. Paul said, at your coming, I was, you know, refreshed to see that you still had the faith. Right? And then in Acts 3:19, there's special times. When you need it, God just steps in and says, bam. When you think you just had it enough and you can't, you're about to just, all of a sudden, looks like it's going to rain. Bam. He just drops it on you. Man, don't worry about dying. You're already dead.
Yeah.
What you said? Well, the doctor gave me a bad case, said I'm going to die. Well, Doc, I died a long time ago.
Right.
It's the only way you can live. Because you're in prison right now. You understand that? You're in prison in your flesh.
Right. That's right.
You live in prison. But one day,
amen.
Man, I can see it like the alien just like, gone, baby. Shazam! Faster than Superman! You know what? Listen, I just love Jesus. And I just, man, I want you to love him too. Because he loves you. He died for you. He laid it all down. You can't serve him half-hearted. You can't. You'll never be accepted. You're fooling yourself. Does it mean that we won't make mistakes? No. It doesn't mean we don't. Do I sin? Yes. I don't go around cursing. I don't go around turning, you know. I'm not like that. I don't, you know, I'm not a drinker. I don't do drugs. I don't do none of that stuff. I don't beat my wife. But it's beyond all of that. It's beyond all of that. Man. Yeah, I sin. Yeah, I holler at my wife. Oh, let me read it to you. Wow, God is so amazing. What? This is crazy. You know, the next thing I wrote right here, it goes right into that. This is not a one-time deal. This is not a one-time deal. No. This is what we're supposed to do every day. Die to self, right? It's the fountains of living water that we continually have to go to. We all need times of refreshing. Especially right now in a dead season. Look outside, all the trees are dead, except if they're evergreens. That means you can understand you're going to be going through some hard times in your life. He gives us the natural to understand the things of the Spirit. But guess what? Springtime's coming. Life.
Amen.
Jesus loves you. Watch this. The times of refreshing. Here's a call. Carl. Brother Carl. Man, that guy. I love him. Brother Carl, when a computer starts acting crazy, this is what he taught me. Brother Carl, when the computer starts acting crazy, there's a little button that you can press. It's called refresh. Refresh. But Carl said, hey, you see that? Just look. Here. Joseph, look. Click right there. He clicked on it. Click. Boom. It reset. Refreshed everything. Man, I've been having all of these problems with this thing. And just refresh. Click. Reflect. How do you do that? Well, we all need it. When I start acting a little crazy, like mom looks at me, need a refresh. When I start acting a little crazy, and I do, now I don't get crazy like that out there, but I get in the flesh, right? My wife tells me, you better go get in your Bible. So my wife tells me, you better go get in your Bible because, well, that's all I'm going to say. That's what she tells me. She said, boy, I could tell you need to go get in your Bible because, well, that's all I'm going to say. That means I need to go get refreshed, right? And I'm like, you better leave me alone, right? So, then, after going, I'm done. Once you've experienced the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, this right here leads you to the door. Once you've experienced this, asking Jesus, he laid his life down for you. When you realize that you're a sinner and need a Savior, and you understand that he paid the price, because there ain't nobody in here holy. Everybody in here has sin. And the only way that sin can be covered is by blood.
Right.
No man can do it. The only one that could do it was Jesus Christ, the perfect Lamb. It's the only way. So once you've experienced that, when you've repented, Father, I'm a sinner and need a Savior. And I don't need to drag you up here to this altar. But when you got that understanding in your life that everything that you've done, if you don't accept Jesus, well, then you're going to have to pay for it. It doesn't matter what you believe. Because if you go all the way back to the very beginning of time, it took a sacrifice of a lamb to cover Adam's sin. They tried to do it by works, by sowing fig leaves. But God said, hey, Adam, that ain't going to work. The innocent has to die. It was about blood then. It's about blood now. And it'll always be about the blood.
Yeah.
You know what's amazing about the blood? Just one drop.
Yeah.
Made everything in the tabernacle, the temple, and anything it splashed on made it holy. If they was killing something and it hit something, it was holy. Bam, belongs to God. Whew. Think about that. When the blood hits you, you are holy. That's why the priest wore a mitre on their forehead, which said, holy as separated unto God for service. To serve. So once you've gone through that, Lord Jesus, and I didn't even get to the sacrifice. Yeah, I did. I covered the sacrifice. The altar, the laver, the sacrifice is Jesus Christ. I showed you guys all the pictures of it through the Bible. Now, after that point, here's where you're at. So, just one drop of the blood of the Lamb of God makes you holy. All you have to do is accept it. You have to understand it in your heart. It's not a simple prayer you say. When God reveals to you for the first time that Jesus laid his life down for you, man, this is the only way. Once you've experienced this, right now, you're standing at the door. At that door. The door. Right? Now, you see, that's not the end. A lot of people go to that, to the cross, accept Jesus, and they leave.
Yeah.
Brother, next week. Next week, we're going to step into the door.
Amen. That's the beginning.
This is the beginning.
Yeah.